last time on earth, I'll praise him. Then forever in that land, there's no cause to fear the crossing, for eternity.
What you want to do?
What are we going to play?
I suspect you better miss it.
Thank you.
Now, how many of y'all wish you could do that? Don't you wish you could just do that? Oh, I wish I could. I wish I could. Some of you might be able to. I just need to find who you are so we could give Kevin and these guys a break every now and then. Well, I picked a song that I'm not sure everybody knows, but that's okay. I'll just sing it as a solo. You know me. I'm not bashful. But I know I love this song. It's got great words. Would you stand with us together and let's sing together? Open up the heavens. That's what we want to have happen tonight as we come together to worship and as we come together to be taught God's word. It goes like this. We've waited for this day. We've gathered in your name. We're calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. The second verse goes like this. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Sing that chorus once again. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. A mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Would you bow with us and let's pray together? Lord, that is our prayer tonight. That is our heart's desire, that you would just fill every part of us with praise to you because of what you've done. Lord, there are a lot of people in this building tonight that are struggling with different things. We're all struggling with what's going on in our nation and around the world. And God, we just pray again for our leadership, that you'd give wisdom, that you'd let them surrender to what you would have them do. And Lord, we pray for people all over this country that are hurting, and especially over in the Ukraine that are hurting. God, it's just so tender to us as we are here and feel so helpless. But God, we pray that you would just send peace to that area. That's our prayer. That's our heart's desire. And Lord, we thank you for a church where we can come and worship you. Come boldly, come without any fear of retribution. And Lord, we just pray that you would help us never to take that for granted, that we would be in a place of worship whenever we're able to, and that we would just come expecting you to do something. Lord, don't ever let us come to a service where we just come and go. Lord, help us to expect something different because we meet with you. Lord, that's our prayer tonight as we've come together to worship and exalt you for who you are. We give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank you. Would you be seated? I'm going to let you sing sitting down, if that's okay with y'all. I know this group here in the center, most of them are my age. They appreciate the opportunity to sit down. Of all the songs I have learned in the last 20 years, this is absolutely my favorite. Jesus, Messiah, name above all names, Emmanuel. Sing it with me together. He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah. His blood, the wine, broken and poured out all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Amazing, oh, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. Blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. Don't forget this phrase. All our hope is in you. All our hope is in you. All the glory to you, God, the light of the world, Jesus Messiah, name above. Blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah. Let angels prostrate fall, bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown. On this terrestrial ball, and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe, and crown him Lord of all. Oh, that with yonder sacred throne we at his feet may fall. Praise tonight in his house. Well, thank you so much for being here. Jamie Odell will be sharing in just a moment, but before he does, we want to turn your attention to the television screen behind me. We have a video we want you to see and listen to. So I'll ask John to turn that video on. And if we need the lights down, we'll do so. But I think the picture may be good.
I was raised in a Christian home, but I gave my parents a really hard time. And so I finally decided to join the military because I wanted to do something hard and actually finish it. And it was actually towards the end of my military service when I gave my life to Christ. And having spent time in the Army, I know that it can be a really spiritually dark place.
They're young. They're far from family for the first time. They don't have maybe a lot of good influences.
A lot of broken homes, marriages struggling, addiction, a desperate need for the gospel. There's a lot of young Marines here, and they're living in the barracks. When we started this church, we knew that that was an area that God was calling us to reach, to host Marines for a Marine dinner once a month is where it started.
To have something like a dinner that they can come to and just be themselves and sit on a couch and eat a warm meal is really impactful for them.
More and more guys started coming, and we baptized our first Marine last summer, and then that Marine led to another Marine and then another one, to the point now where every week we're seeing fruit.
This church, like, means business. They are not okay with you just punching your church card every week.
It was obvious that this was a church that was doing church like the Bible says we should do church.
I feel encouraged every time I go to church. Like, I wish every day was Sunday.
When people give to Annie Armstrong, it enables churches like ours to reach military members and their families with the gospel.
Washington, D.C. is a city with many, many nations. So to have a gospel-centered, healthy church here is reaching not only the people in this city, but cities all across the world.
The military is already moving people around, and as they're moved from place to place, they can take the gospel with them. It's exactly what Jesus has called us to do, and God is changing people's lives.
Hi, welcome to day 4 of the Week of Prayer for North American Missions. And today I have two grandchildren with me, Donovan, who's 8, and Autumn, who is 5, and they're going to help us pray for the missionaries of the day. And the missionaries for day 4 are Jared and Jennifer Huntley, and they live in Washington, D.C. Donovan, can you put your star in the Washington on the West Coast? That's where we live. We live in One Washington. Autumn, can you put your star in the other Washington, Washington, D.C., District of Columbia, on the other side of the United States? That's where the Huntleys live, and they work with military families in the Washington, D.C. area. Do you guys know anybody who is in the military?
Daddy.
Oh, show the picture. There's a picture of your dad. Your dad was in the military. He was an Army guy in the military. So we're going to be praying for the Huntleys who work with military people. Autumn, can you open the Bible for me? Do you see that marker there?
Mm-hmm.
The Bible gives us a special message about prayer. And it says right here, pray for one another. So we are going to pray for the Huntleys.
It's already been about.
Thank you, Autumn. So two of the prayer requests from the Huntleys are, let me read that one, please.
This one's
one prayer request they have is to pray for them that they would make friends. Yes, please. And the military bases is in their community around Pillar Church. And the other prayer request they have is that the military people will love God and want to go tell people about Jesus as the military moves them around. So let's pray for the missionaries today. You guys get ready to pray. Donna, would you set that down, please? Okay, let's get ready to pray. Dear God, we thank you for our missionaries of the Huntleys all the way in Washington, D.C., and we pray that you would help them make friends on the military bases and in the community around Pillar Church. And we also pray for, that all the military people would love God and that they would go tell other people about Jesus as they travel with the military. Thank you for today. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for joining us today.
We need to pray for that mom because she's in that tiny little place with those two kids, and I'm sure she got her hands full. Whew. All right. Now, tonight we're going to be looking at James chapter 5. And I'm not sure how I need to, if I should hit Pastor Buddy or if I should thank him. But as you get through these 12 verses of James chapter 5, you will realize that it's not an uplifting message. It's not a positive message. It's not one of those that says, hey, please, can I preach on that one? Because we're going to talk about money, we're going to talk about suffering, and then we're going to talk about swearing, all right? So I'm telling you, you will leave here changed and encouraged and forever different as a result of studying this passage of James chapter 5, all right? So bear with me as I am very excited for the opportunity. I'm always excited to open God's word and to teach God's word and to really see what God's word has for us. And you'll know that different pastors and different teachers have different approaches. And, you know, some pastors like to think about things topically, like they're going to cover a topic. I appreciate the opportunity to step through verse by verse, chapter by chapter of a book of the Bible. So when we do that, we come to difficult passages like this, and we just have to embrace the fact that we were meant to hear this message for tonight. And so we're going to hear this message for tonight, and we know that it's from God. And so while it would be very easy to say the first five words, now listen, you rich people. Some of you could say, well, he ain't talking to me. So I'll wait till he gets to the second point because that one, first part is not about me. Now, I'll just give you some perspective, okay? So there's a website, something along the lines of like rate my wealth in the world. And so you can put in your annual income into this little box, how many people are living in your home, and then it comes up with how you rate in the world. So I said, all right, let's just start at the poverty line. So the poverty line is anywhere between $15,000 and $25,000 annually. So I put in $20,000 with two adults and two children. In the world, if you make $20,000 a year, I'm in the richest 26.7% of the global population. I'm richer than 73% of the world. Now, I looked at some census stuff. The average income for a family in Trustville is $94,000. And I don't think that one made it up here, but you're in the richest 10% of the world. So when we read a verse like this says, now listen, you rich people, you could say, well, I'm not rich. I don't have a lot of money. Even the poorest of people, we would say here in the United States, in a global perspective, are rich. All right, so there's something for us to hear, and I pray that you will hear it with a heart of love and the heart of God. So let's read verses 1 through 6 of James chapter 5. Now listen, you rich people. It only gets better from there. Weep and wail because of the misery that is coming on you. Your wealth has rotted and moths have eaten your clothes. Your gold and silver are corroded. Their corrosion will testify against you and eat your flesh like fire. You have hoarded wealth in the last days. Look, the wages you failed to pay the workers who mowed your fields are crying out against you. The cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord Almighty. You have lived on earth in luxury and self-indulgence. You have fattened yourselves in the day of slaughter. You have condemned and murdered the innocent one who was not opposing you. So there's warnings here. James gives us warnings to the rich. And what he's saying is that it's not a sin to have money. The problem here is how you got your money, all right? So if we want to look at the worldly way to wealth, all right, you can write a book on the worldly way to wealth. Hoard your wealth. You can hoard it. Just keep it all for yourself. Don't give anything away. Whatever you earn, hang on to it. Don't spend it. Don't do anything with it. Just hang on to it. Keep hoarding it. Acquiring wealth by wrong means. Luxurious living. And if you're hoarding it, you can live luxuriously. And then you can use people, condemn and murder innocent people. You end up using people to gain more wealth. Now, I don't know what's going on specifically for these people who have been displaced, as James writes to the tribes who have been displaced. But obviously, there's some people who are using some worldly ways to continue to bolster their bank account and to separate themselves from the common person. So I say that it's not wrong to have money and to use money and to work hard for your money. So what's the godly way to wealth? Well, the first thing is invest and save, but also be generous. You can work hard to earn wages, a message that our young people need to hear so much. Work hard to earn your wages. Live your life in a way that you are free to give and to bless others. And then lastly, don't use people to gain wealth, but use your wealth to gain people. And by that I mean, use your wealth to be a blessing to people so that they may see the love of Christ and be brought into the kingdom. So we have these competing ways that people can get wealthy. And I think James here is saying he has a really strong, I mean, this is a very strong warning to those people in how they were getting wealthy. And the perspective is, you can work your whole entire life and gain up all of these things. And then you cease to exist and you no longer have those things because they're not coming with you. Now, it would be very easy, and our human nature is very easy to say, well, what's the threshold of what's okay and what's not okay? How much money is too much money, and how much should I be giving, and how much should I be paying my employees if I have employees, and how much should I be holding back for myself to make sure that my kids and my grandkids? That's a very common, very easy transition for us to make in our minds, and what I would encourage you to do is to just look at your heart. All right, so examine yourself. Am I using the resources God has blessed me with for kingdom purposes? Am I using them for kingdom purposes? Now, I'm not just up here saying you should be tithing more. I'm not up here saying you should be giving money to every organization that comes and knocks on your door. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying, are you using the resources God has given you to impact the kingdom? The second thing. Am I investing not only my resources, but my heart into the lives of others? Sometimes it's much easier to give $10 or to write that check for $100 or to buy something that's going to help someone else. Sometimes that's really easy. The more difficult thing to do is come in. Let me help you. Let me fix you a dinner and let me talk with you and let me invest some time and energy and love into you without just giving you this money. So it's really a heart issue. It's not an amount issue. It's not a ledger issue. It's not a checkbook issue. It really is a heart issue. And you know, if you have a generous heart or if you have a little tight-fisted heart, you know that. So examine yourself, ask God, because you don't want to be guilty of the things that James is warning us about here in chapter 5. All right, so that was just a reminder to the rich, all right? And y'all are uplifted and excited and just beaming with joy. I can see it on your faces. The second thing, a statement to the suffering. I told you it was going to get better. Brothers and sisters, as an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets. I'm sorry, verse 7. Be patient then, brothers and sisters, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop, patiently waiting for the autumn and the spring rains. You too, be patient and stand firm, because the Lord is coming near. Don't grumble against one another, brothers and sisters, or you will be judged. The judge is standing at the door. Brothers and sisters, as an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. As you know, we count as blessed those who have persevered. You have heard of Job's perseverance. You've seen what the Lord finally brought about. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. So the first message is to the rich, and then this message is to those who were being oppressed by the rich. Now it would be hard-pressed for us to say that we are oppressed as a nation, as a country, as a city, as a church. We can be oppressed individually. We can feel left out of the circle in our workplaces, in our homes, and that sort of thing. But this oppression is really is back-breaking oppression, that my livelihood, the physical life that I'm living, is in shambles. My emotional health is struggling as a result of that. And so the cure for that, which is so easy to do, James tells us, be patient. Just wait. And I don't know if you've had to wait. As a child, it feels, when I tell my 11-year-old son, hey, let's wait 5 minutes before we can go do this. You might as well say, let's wait 150 years. For us, the Lord tells us, I have something for you, but we just need to wait. We just need to wait. Wait on the right timing. We can be like that 3 or 4-year-old and start stomping our feet and being impatient and saying, why not now? So it's difficult to hear the words, be patient, because there's no end to that time. If you say, hey, it's going to take about 45 minutes, or like the cable company says, we'll be out there between 12 and 8. Thank you for that 8-hour window. I will be gladly waiting here until you can arrive, all right? There's an end goal, like at least they'll be here before 8. Maybe. Until they call you and say, we're running behind. But anyway, so the words be patient is not something that we in our society like to hear, because we have come accustomed to this. If we want it, we'll go get it. If we need it, we'll go get it quicker. If someone else needs something, I might help them go get it now. And so we've perpetuated this idea that if there's something that we want or need, we go get it. And sometimes God is telling us, be patient. The term be patient, there's lots of words and definitions kind of mixed in with the word patient, but be of long spirit, not lose heart, to be brave while enduring misfortunes and troubles, slow in avenging. Ouch, that one hurt. Slow to punish. Ouch, that one hurt. In other words, be long-tempered. Long-tempered. Short fuse. That's a lot easier. That's a whole lot easier. Take care of it quickly. Something has wronged you, take care of it quickly. To be long-tempered, to allow God to do something that you can't do, is really what it means to be patient. So he gives us three examples of the patience that he's talking about. Patience like the farmer. The farmer prepares the field. Then he waits for the right time to plant. And then he plants the seed. And then he waits. And he waits. He waits for that rain. Then he waits until it's harvest time. And then at harvest time, he waits until he can gather that harvest and he can reap the benefits of that harvest. Or what about the prophets? We're going to get to this in a little bit about anticipating Christ's return. And you think about the prophets who preceded Jesus and Jesus' initial coming to earth. Think about the amount of years that existed between some of the prophecies and the actual happening. It's not a week or 2 weeks. Years, hundreds of years. So those prophets, they were patient. They were proclaiming a message that they themselves probably wouldn't see fulfilled. But what about Job? Good night. That is a terrible, terrible way to go. To live a life of being upright and perfect. And God using that in his life and in the midst of his losing everything, he was not going to turn his back on God. And God blessed that. God used that in his life to bless him doubly than what he originally had. I don't know at what point my faith would begin to crumble having the comforts and the love that I have in my own life. You know, I stub a toe and I start to question, is there a God? Is there a God that would allow my toe to be stubbed on this table for the 14th time? When you think about Job, who endured so much heartache, so much loss, and he was patient. So that's the kind of patience that we long for. And we don't ever want to pray for patience. That's hard, because he'll give you a child or he'll give you a grandchild. I love children and I love grandchildren. I don't have grandchildren, but I love your grandchildren. You may not all the time, and that's okay. They're teaching you patience, okay? So we have this warning to the rich people. We have this statement to those who are suffering. And then we have this order to oath takers. Oath takers. If you say, that's hard to say really fast, I'm telling you right now. Verse 12, above all, my brothers and sisters, do not swear, not by heaven or by earth or by anything else. All you need is a simple yes or no. Otherwise, you will be condemned. Now, this is not talking about cursing, although I think James would agree you probably shouldn't curse, all right? But he's talking about taking an oath. And he's talking about taking an oath under the false pretense that if I can swear by heaven or I can't even say this out loud, but swearing to the Father, so that someone will try to make someone believe you more than they already do. I'll say this: I've seen on TV shows people say, "I swear on my mama's grave," "I swear on my dog," or "I swear on my." Anyone will swear on a cat because there's no point. All right. So swear on a cat all you want. That's okay. All right. But you can see people whose lives do not reflect trust and strong character, so that when they look you in the eye and say, "I will do that," you can believe them. They have to call on something else in a way to help you to believe that they're actually going to do it. So don't do that. The heart of the issue here is not the object or the person on which you take an oath. The issue here is character and trust. And he's reminding these people, let your character and the way that you live your life be so evident that when you say yes or no, there's no doubt in anyone's mind what you really mean when you say yes or no. We have a judicial system in which you can say one thing and then not be guilty of what you just said you did. I don't understand it. It doesn't make sense to this really simple-minded man. But as believers, have the backbone to say no when we need to say no. And if there's something we're going to do, by George, we do it. And we do it with all of our might. Because God receives the glory when we as believers have our character and our trust fortified by the fact that we fulfill what we say we're going to do or not do. So there's nothing wrong with putting your hand on the Bible if you're called to testify into a court of law. Don't say, "Hey, there was this pastor at the church, First Baptist Church, that said I shouldn't do this." Don't do that, okay? We don't need them calling us. And you can put your hand on the Bible and say, "I'm going to tell the truth, the whole truth, and everything." No, and also the whole truth, not anything but the truth. That words, I mean, you can just switch those words and it means something completely different. So that's okay to do that. Just don't do it in how you live your life, in your common interaction with people. Don't think that you let your character determine whether or not someone believes if you say you're going to do something or not. So, rich people, don't be jerks. Those who are suffering, just be patient. And if you're going to take an oath, do it honestly by your character and how you live your life, not by trying to call on a gravestone, a dead relative, the clouds, the heaven, whatever. Let your yes be yes and your no be no. Now, I told you it was going to be uplifting and exciting and life-changing. But there may be just one little thing in your life that you just need to tweak as a result. And you know, if you make a lot of small little tweaks in your life over the course of 4 or 5 years, you've made a big old change. Made a big old change. Well, let's pray, and then y'all can be dismissed. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you for our time together. Lord, we thank you for this passage. And as difficult it is, we do thank you for what you have for us in this passage. We don't pretend like we are above it or below it or somehow immune from it. We understand that you have something for us, and I pray that you would, by your Spirit, work in our lives so that we can see those elements in our life that we need a little adjustment. Lord, I pray that your Spirit would speak loudly to us, that we would make those, we'd be obedient, and we would see those things that we need to change, and that you'd remind us over and over and over again that we need to follow hard after you. And Lord, as we come to verses like this, that we'll adhere to those and we'll obey those, that we'll not just hear them, but we will be doers of your word. And Lord, we thank you for our time tonight, and I pray that you'd bless us as we leave. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Y'all have a lovely, lovely evening.
Close up.